any better.
Good morning and welcome to Valmont Community Presbyterian Church on this wonderful day the Lord has made. Are there any announcements? Anne.
I'm just going to do a really quick demo here. Y'all can hear me? Okay.
I think if I'm back here, you can't hear me so well.
When you make an announcement or a prayer request, can you please like stand right up to the mic? I got called out on this myself this morning. I usually try to be really good, but it helps when people know who you're praying for. Thanks.
Anne, please show people how you can move the microphone up and down.
Oh, you can do. If you're tall, be sure to move it up or not.
Thank you. I just want to announce that cookies for Together, formerly Attention Homes, are due next week. If you want to bring them on Sunday morning, that's great. Otherwise, meet me here between 2 and 2:30 on Monday, and I will deliver them. Also, the final Women's Association meeting for this year is a week from Wednesday, which I believe, oh my goodness, I think it's, I just went, I knew 5 minutes ago, but now I can't. But anyway, if you will be doing our last session for the year, and of course we'll be following it up with a potluck. So if you are interested at all, please come and join us 10 o'clock, the third Wednesday of the month. Thank you.
I think that's the 18th. just calculating by Sundays. That's how I do everything now.
You too.
Well, it's good to be back with you all. So, and thank you for how everybody pulled together last week as I was away. I do appreciate all of that. We have a few things coming up here. The first is, I'll say for Mike, that vintage articles are due on the 17th. So if you have any recipes, articles, pictures, anecdotes that you'd like to send in, I'm sure he'd be happy to have those. Also, this upcoming Saturday will be the memorial service for Bob Travis. So if you are able to join us for that at 11 a.m., that will be here. I haven't spoken yet with Ella, so I'm not going to put her on the spot right now as to whether or not she wants that also simulcast. And if that's okay, then I will send out that link tomorrow. So I'll find out and let you all know. That's all that I have.
Please join me in the call to worship, which is taken from the 27th Psalm. Please stand if you're able. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life.
To gaze on the beauty of the Lord
and to seek him in his temple. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living.
Wait for the Lord.
Be strong
and take heart and wait for the Lord.
For those of you at home, if you have a candle, please light it at this time so that together we may share in the light of Christ. And now please remain standing for hymn number 401. If I ever were lay leader and didn't make a mistake, you guys would think it was somebody else. But besides wishing you a wonderful Sunday, it's Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day, whether or not you're a mother. Have a great day. And now, the assurance of pardon.
You need to hear the assurance of pardon.
Thank you. I will read the assurance of pardon, which will be followed by a prayer of confession. We'll say together, or we'll pray together. And then there will be a few moments of silence for each of us to confess our own sins. Our Lord knows what we need before we ask. Our God is full of grace and compassion, not wanting to lose one who is lost. So taste and see that our Lord is good. Through the work of the Messiah, you have been reconciled to God. Amen. Now let's pray together. Merciful God, in your gracious presence, we confess our sin and the sin of this world. Although Christ is among us as our peace, we are a people divided against ourselves as we cling to the values of a broken world. The profit and pleasures we pursue lay waste your good creation. The fears and jealousies that we harbor set neighbor against neighbor and nation against neighbor. Lord, have mercy upon us, heal and forgive us. Set us free to serve you in the world as agents of a reconciling love in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. If you're able, please rise and stand for the Gloria.
Blessing and honor and glory.
you all so much for that. Oh, you can actually stay up here if you like. So any young folk want to come forward? How are you all doing today? Good. Have you ever seen these before? Do you know what this is for? This is a game called bocce ball. And you'll see that these are both some red balls and this little white ball here. And the goal of the game is that you're trying to get the balls as close to the, wow, this really rolls in here. You're trying to get it as close to the white ball as possible. So, that's gonna go sailing past, and I'm gonna try not to destroy the, Rex is really helping me out here. In this game, what you're trying to do is get the balls as close together as you can, and usually what you'd be doing is playing as a team. So your goal is to work with one another so that you can score as many points as possible. And you can't do it on your own, as clearly seen by what I just did. You need the help of your teammates in order to play the game properly. And one of the things that we're going to be talking about in the service today is about community, and specifically community within the church, and how we aren't able to do the Christian life on our own, but we need each other to help each other out. We need each other's support, whether it's another person who's throwing the ball to get it close, or Rex who's stopping it so I don't break the camera. And we all have to work together in order to come closer to Christ. And that's one of the wonderful things about being in a group like this, where as we gather together, we get to share in the work of Christ. And you know what? In cases like this, sometimes the work of Christ can be a lot of fun to do together too. So I hope that you enjoy your time with the leaders who are going to take you out, but let's go ahead and take a moment to pray. Loving God, we thank you for bringing us together. Not only for the work that we get to do together, but the life, the celebration, the joy, the play. We ask, God, that you would help for these things to be honoring and glorifying to you as we continue with one another to pursue your good work in the world. We pray these things in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, it's good to see you all, and we'll see you later. Thanks, Rex. We come to a point in our service today where we have an opportunity to join with one another in prayer and praise. So if you have a prayer request or a praise that you'd like lifted up, I would invite for those of you in the sanctuary to come forward to the mic, those of you who are with us online to unmute yourself, and then we will join with one another in prayer and praise. Holy and gracious Lord, we thank you for the incredible gift of being gathered together as your children, with the opportunity to join with one another in prayer and praise, to support each other in both our sorrows and our joys. And so, God, as we continue to follow after the life that you have given us as a family to live out in the world, we ask that we would follow after your Son and be empowered and equipped by your Spirit to be a people of hope and of joy, not only in our lives together, but with all of those that we meet in the world. God, as we strive after this kind of life, we know that we can come before you with all confidence. And so we join with Christ and with all of his church in the words of the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As we continue in worship, we have the joyous opportunity of responding to the good news that we have received as we collect our tithes and our offerings. If you are visiting with us today, I pray that you will feel no obligation to give, as this is something that we as a family are committed to doing with one another. However, if you would like to partner with us in our continued efforts of proclaiming our Lord's life and light into this world, you are welcome to do so.
I ask that you would now give with a worshipful and a generous heart.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all the blessings you give us every day out of love for us. And especially today, we think of family and mothers and thank you for those wonderful people who sustain us and provide a link really to your love, but your ultimate love was in giving us Jesus in the cross, and we thank you for that. Bless these gifts now, given in love for you and what you've done for us. May they be used to further your kingdom here on earth. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the second chapter of Titus, verses 11 through 15. You will find this on page 1857 of your pew Bible. The word of our Lord. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age. While we wait for the blessed hope the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are, for his very own, eager to do what is good. These, then, are the things you should teach, encourage, and rebuke with all authority. Do not let anyone despise you. My friends, the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for the incredible gift of being able to gather around your word spoken to us. We ask that through the presence of your Spirit in our lives, that our hearts and our minds might be opened and enlivened to you so that we might discern all that you would teach us this day. To this end, God, I ask that you would test these words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts. May these be found pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. About a year after returning to faith in Christ, although I was still struggling with what exactly I believed about the church, I found myself in a longer car ride with a friend and coworker of mine. Somehow, the conversation turned to faith, which, admittedly, a number of my conversations do. I told her about how I one day hoped to found my own worshiping community, one that wasn't ensnared by all of the foibles that I'd seen in the churches of my youth. After my detailed account of what I thought this kind of church would entail, my friend eventually asked, "Wouldn't it be terrible to attend a church that was just filled with people like you?" I don't think she's just meaning me, but over the last couple of Sundays, we've explored some of the odds and ends of Christian life with our considerations of both doubt and baptism. Baptism is not only given as a gift to the individual being baptized, but to the entire church of God as people are welcomed into the covenant community. Doubt, as we saw with Thomas, is best addressed within a community that has room for those doubts, and also going about trying to answer them not through correction, but through shared worship and mission. So it should come as no surprise today that we must examine the nature of Christian community in greater depth. But what is Christian community? Since we each individually are called to confess Christ as Lord, is community truly an essential aspect of the Christian life? What's so great about being responsible for other people, anyways? Now, we should begin by noting that we live within a novel moment in human history. The degree of independence afforded us is staggering. It is feasible now to live without close ties to our families of origin, our chosen families, spouses, children, or even workplace acquaintances. Western individualism, late capitalism, and high-speed communications have made it possible for people to live and work wherever they like, to shop without seeing the lives of the people around them, to engage with information from all over the world with instantaneous gratification. Now, I'm not trying to be particularly curmudgeonly about any of these realities. I am merely suggesting that our cultural landscape won't perceive of community in the same way that our forebears might have. For example, in the ancient Near East, hospitality wasn't merely about being nice. It was a matter of life and death for those who were traveling long distances in hostile environments. People longed to be close to their relatives, not simply out of affection for them, but because these were a group of people upon whom they could rely for their survival. Giving aid to someone in your tribe wasn't about only helping a neighbor in need, but was a way of making the whole group stronger, increasing the ability to withstand one's opponents. And much in the way that the rugged individualism of late modernity has its pros and its cons, so too does the communitarian impulse that both strengthens and isolates collective societies. Now, the point is that our value around community will differ depending on our context. But what does any of this have to do with the Christian life and the role of community for both the church and its individual members? Now for that, let's turn to the book of Titus, sent by Paul to the titular young pastor in his first call to a challenging context of ancient Crete. Epimenides, one of Crete's own philosophers, said of his countrymen, "Cretans are always liars, evil brutes, lazy gluttons." And it is into this culture of backbiting and infighting that Titus is meant to cultivate a new kind of community, one that has the spirit of Christ to it. Now, much like how Epimenides pulled no punches in his critique of Crete, so too does Paul go all the way in his words of hope for what the people of this island might become. He begins our passage saying, "The grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people." The appearance of God's grace is not a vague theological principle, but rather the embodied presence of the Lord Jesus Christ, who taught in word and deed how we might reject ungodliness and worldly passions, so we might live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. Paul goes on to reiterate the centrality of Jesus to this kind of present life as we patiently await his return. However, as we look for his coming, we are not idle. We are not simply sitting on our hands, but rather as we are being redeemed from all wickedness, we are being purified as a people to be eager to do what is good. Now, there is a lot to unpack in these few short verses, so let's begin with a countercultural message to the people of Paul's own day. God's grace has come for all people. The community wrought by God's grace is not limited to a single family or tribe or nation, but rather is meant to weave all people together. And if we're going to be honest, this remains deeply controversial today, as the broader culture continues to look for ways to determine who's in and who's out, often with gleeful abandon. Beyond that, our notion that we can go about life alone is soundly refuted by the kind of life that Paul is describing. For it is only together, through Christ's work in us, that we jointly can be a people who live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. Only together are we eager to do what is good. We need one another to encourage us in what is right and to rebuke us in what is wrong. Rather than following after the individualistic task of living how we want, when we want, where we want. And how could we ever live into such a high calling without one another? Christian community preserves us when it becomes too difficult to sustain good work by any human effort. Any individual will eventually grow weary in doing good if they believe that they themselves are the ones who are going to enact God's plans for the world. It is in Christ that we trust. So it is when Christ is working through Don and Marlene as a couple that we see the ability to sustain the effort of good work. It is when Sean joins in with Randy, usually Stephen over there playing music, that they can support one another. It's when Mike and Mike join together and work around the property that they can guarantee that there is the ability to sustain each other through that task. It is when Stella May joins with Carol and Elaine in acts of prayer that they can sustain each other through that good work for the sake of the church. Now, I could look around the room and name each and every one of you and voice the ways that you unite with one another in sharing the difficult and glorious task of being God's community together. But that's ultimately not the point. The point is that it is with each other, not just looking at what individual people are doing, that we share the task of being God's people for the world, a people that God has chosen to be zealous for doing good works in this present age. If any of you were to tackle such a monumental task on your own, how could you possibly endure without losing heart? Christian community is brought together so as to counter the two competing impulses of the world, to stand alone as an island unto oneself, or to serve only those that we identify as looking and being like us. Christian community unites us together in Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from wickedness, as Paul writes here. And since it is Christ who forms this community, then we are meant to live and act like him in the present. Christian community is Christ between us. And so we do not live in a way that primarily seeks to serve ourselves, but rather to follow in the way of Christ's self-giving for the sake of the entire world. Now, when I consider the kind of community that Paul hopes to see in Crete and by extension in all of the church, I can't help but think of that conversation nearly two decades ago with that friend of mine. I was falling into the old trap of wanting to make a community that looked like me, where I could easily support its other members, since in the end, that would be a self-serving act. Instead, the community that Paul envisions is meant to hone one another, encouraging and rebuking, so that we all together come to look more and more like Christ our Lord. Yes, I did want us to do that in the kind of community I envisioned, but through a decidedly Eric-driven lens. Instead, we are to become pure and useful for the difficult work of life together, so that we might give of ourselves to the world. Now, it's all fine and good to discuss the importance of Christian community, but how do we go about fostering it? What can we do to become with one another a people who are eager, who are zealous to do good works? Drawing from this text, I would primarily encourage for you to pursue mission together. And as a little plug, that's what we're discussing next week. So much of what Paul hopes to see take place in Crete is a community that lives holy lives in the present. Earlier, he said that this behavior will make the teaching about God, our Savior, attractive. We are to live and speak in a way that will make the gospel attractive to the people around us. That is, we are to live in a way that actually makes the good news seem like good news. So do something with the people from this community that does just this. Go and demonstrate the value of being a people who are united for good work within Christ's kingdom. Set someone free from their debts through your generosity. Set someone free from their mistakes through your forgiveness. Set someone free from their isolation through your friendship. And when you grow weary in this work, and you will grow weary, be strengthened by others in the community who share this work with you as well. And in order to sustain one another when we grow weary, we must do as Paul commands by encouraging and rebuking with authority. When we see people in the family sapped of energy and feeling discouraged, it falls to us to bring them encouragement. Stand alongside of them and shore them up. Be understanding about why it might be difficult for them in this present moment to take on some other task. Help them to get the rest that they need. Similarly, but far more difficult, we must also rebuke one another in the community when we stray from the call to be self-controlled, upright, and godly. We must counter one another when we no longer seek to do good works, but only act in self-serving or group-serving ways. Remember that we are challenging the old model of tribal community and the new model of narcissistic isolationism. We must keep one another focused on how Christ, as God's grace, is bringing salvation to all people through an act of self-giving. And finally, when Paul tells us that we are to be purified, note that it doesn't say that it is our mission to go and purify others. It is not our task as a church to become a kind of moral police force that seeks to unveil the failings of others, but rather we are to partner with Christ in being a pure people. Nothing will destroy community quicker than a spirit of perpetual criticism devouring one another. So when you find yourself picking apart another person's failures, looking for ways to criticize them and demean them, be sure to remember Jesus' own comment from his Sermon on the Mount, "Do not judge, or you too will be judged." Now, whether you think that that is God judging you, or it's just going to create a culture where everybody is judging one another, there's still powerful words to heed and hear. Leave it to Jesus to address the sins of the world, instead focusing on your own failings, and then ask for Jesus to bring you liberation from your brokenness. If you are most aware of how you yourself need to be purified, followed by the purity of the community, then we might in fact live genuine lives in the world that make the gospel attractive to the people around us. My friends, there is so much more that might be said about Christian community. But Paul's words today do offer a good place to begin. Remember that we are not gathered only for ourselves, but for the sake of making Christ's grace known through all of the world. And so may you earnestly pursue good work with one another, for it is only together that you will be able to endure in this work to the very end. And so, by the grace of our Lord and through the equipping of the Holy Spirit, may you bring all glory and honor to the Father, both in the present age and in the age to come. Amen. Holy and gracious God, we thank you for the incredible gift of including us in the good work of your kingdom. May we, God, through the work of Christ in the presence of the Spirit, be useful to you in the act of self-giving that you continue in all of the world. May people find this community attractive and thus come to glorify you. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I would invite for you all to stand and to join us in our concluding hymn. I want it to be known that it's true that sometimes the slides don't advance. Thank you, Rex, for doing that for us today. But as you prepare to leave, if you're with us in the sanctuary, I'd invite for you to go and to greet the people back in the back of the sanctuary on the Zoom station. And now, as you go forth into the world, may you join with one another in remaining committed to the acts of being a people of worship and of mission, a people who are joined together in purity and a zeal for good works. May you do all of this for the sake of bringing glory to God through the power of the Spirit, following after Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Yes.
Turn and share a sign of our Lord's peace with one another.
Be with you.
Doug, how's the trailer?
It's doing just fine. The only thing that happened was some of the trim got boiled off the front. 100 degrees in the sun.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
When did you catch it?
Wednesday night.
Okay. Well, he'll be just a mile of cake.
Yeah, I caught it actually from our fishing guide, which is unusual because we're out in a drift boat.
Right.
But we rode in the truck with to and from, and must have got it. He got sick Tuesday night, really, really sick. And, anyway, thank goodness for the vaccine.
Yep.
You know, it's just so far a bad cold. So.
Scott, Florida's treating you well? Yeah, it is.
Hot?
Yeah.
Hot?
Good call. Yeah, Scott. You hear me, Scott?
Thank you, Madoka.